Hi, everybody. Welcome to Pittsburgh Sports Memories. My name is Tim Hannon.
And I'm Steve Wirt.
And as always, we're going to venture back to a Pittsburgh sports moment of the past and talk about it. This episode, we're going to talk about a goal that Jaromir Jagr scored in 1999 that some people, including Jagr, claim literally saved the Pittsburgh Penguins franchise. Whether or not it did, well, we'll talk about that. So the Penguins in the 1990s were pretty successful at the onset of the decade. In 1991 and 1992, they win back-to-back Stanley Cups. And they are the toast of the town. Just definitely really ingrained themselves in the consciousness of the city. And they're pretty successful the rest of the decade. However, it's kind of a mixed record. It's they have a lot of success, but they also miss a lot of opportunities. And it's a lot of unfulfilled promise because they never do get back to the Stanley Cup Finals. And little by little, the key pieces of those teams kind of start leaving. Larry Murphy and Kevin Stevens and Ron Francis. And the big hitter happens after the 1997 season when Mario Lemieux, who is the greatest player, obviously, in the history of the franchise, decides to retire. He's really riddled by back injuries, cancer, everything else. And he says, you know what, I can't do this anymore. And he retires at age 31. Which is a little shocking, but given the injuries, I think it's understandable. And so by the time we get to the end of the decade, by the 98-99 season, again, many of those core pieces are gone, except for one guy, Jaromir Jagr. Jagr was, I believe, an 18-year-old rookie when they won the first cup. And by this point, it's his team. It's his team. He's the captain, and he's probably the best player in the world. Also, by this time, the NHL has undergone quite a transformation. It's now a very defensive-minded league. The teams that used to win were the Edmonton Oilers in the 80s or the Penguins of those early 90s, teams that could score a lot of goals, teams that had speed, flew up and down the ice. By the time we get to the end of the decade, it's now teams like the New Jersey Devils and the Florida Panthers, teams that play this clutch and grab style of hockey. And Steve, I know it's a style that many fans detest, including, I think, us at the time.
Yeah, I think too, like there's always been a theory I've heard is in 1967, the league did expand by six teams, and hockey was so regional back then that it probably took almost 20 years for the talent to kind of catch up. And then the goaltending too was like, there was a lot of stand-up goaltenders, and then Brodeur came in and there was another guy with the butterfly, which I just call ice sitting. Like, you know, it's basically the old Mighty Ducks joke, you know, just get a big kid to sit in the net, you know. So there's some of that, but too, the main thing was, like you said, the clutching and grabbing. And they had you weren't allowed to have a two-line pass, which means you could set all your guys up on the center red, and you couldn't pass pack, and they could just trap you between the blue and the red line, which was kind of the whole goal. And with being able to grab, that totally negates any speed through the neutral zone, so it makes it very difficult. And you had said the Penguins were the toast of the town. Was that the avocado toast, or we were a little before that, I guess?
Avocado toast will do. Although it's Pittsburgh, you have to pick a more blue collar toast, I think.
Maybe a Reuben sandwich or something.
There you go.
Yeah.
The NHL is definitely, you mentioned the trap, and the trap is really what's dominating play right now. And that's not a style that the Penguins ever really adapt to. That's not their style of play. It's never been. It never was. They're still trying to build around offense. And so it's not good for them. It's not good for the league. It's not good for the fans. Heading into that 98-99 season, again, Jagr, best player in the league, best player in the world. The rest of the team really isn't that good. The only other really borderline star was Martin Straka, who, you know, wasn't really that great. He did some really good things for the Penguins later on. But at this point, he's now on his second stint with the Penguins. And he really had been mostly a disappointment up to this point, at least. And if you look up and down the roster, I went back and looked at the roster for this year in preparation for this episode, and just pulled some names off of there. You know, Jan Herdina, Brad Wawrinka, Kip Miller, Yermin Titov, who had a pretty good season that year, because I believe he centered Jagr's line. Alexei Morozov, who was a guy that a Russian player that had a lot of talent, but never really became what he was supposed to become.
He ended up being a much better KHL player than he ever did in the NHL for whatever reason.
Which is awesome for the KHL, but wasn't so great for the Pens when they needed him. Kevin Hatcher was probably their best defenseman. That's not saying a lot.
Well, that was the old, let's sign the guy that always scored goals against us or did well against us. I mean, okay, I guess at least he can't do well against you now.
Yeah, the Pittsburgh sports teams have a long history of anytime we sign the guy that killed us and said, oh, good, that guy always played so well against us, now he plays for us. It's like never worked out well. I can think of just like examples off the top of my head. You know, John LeClair, who the Penguins signed a few years later, stunk for us. He used to kill us. And then even into other sports, Derek Bell for the Pirates, that was a disaster. He always killed us. Who was the kick returner for the Ravens? Jacoby Jones. Remember Jacoby Jones?
We had Jacoby Jones. Wow, I forgot.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he had – I wish I had the stat in front of me, but he had something like he had something like negative 11 return yards or something on the season. It was some terrible stat. But, you know, guys like that, and Kevin Hatcher was one of those guys. I mean, he wasn't terrible for the Penguins, but he certainly wasn't – you know, they sort of got him – They had Larry Murphy was their sort of like anchor defenseman. Then it was Sergei Zubov for a while. And by this point, it's Hatcher. And Hatcher's just nowhere near those other guys. So just up and down the roster, not a very good roster. Robbie Brown was on that team. He was also on his second stint with the Penguins, a guy that was really good in the late 80s. And by 1999 was, you know, a shell of his former self. Also wasn't playing next to Lemieux, which really was his bread and butter for making him who he was. I mean, I loved Robbie Brown, but he really wasn't that great without Lemieux next to him. So just not a very good roster. The goaltending duties, I said Jagr was the only one left from the Cup teams. That's not entirely true. Tom Barrasso is still one of the goaltenders, and he was the goaltender for the Cup teams. But by this point in his career, Barrasso is often injured. And he's platooning with Peter Skudra in the net. So Brass is still there, but he's certainly not that effective anymore. And the head coach at this point is a guy named Kevin Constantine. He's actually heading into his second season. They had hired him the year before. And he was known for kind of being a disciplinarian. That was a little bit different of a coach to hire for the Penguins. But again, the way the league was headed and the way the roster was made up, they decided that would be a better approach, kind of hiring like a tough disciplinarian. Constantine had been the coach of the San Jose Sharks when they were an expansion team. He had some success there. And so Craig Patrick and the ownership decided that this guy might be, you know, the guy to sort of take this new team over. And again, discipline, defensive style coaching did not really gel that well with the offensively geared Penguins. Certainly did not gel well with Jaromir Jagr. Those two had some falling outs, I believe.
Yeah, it still was there trying to, you know, play to the trend of defensive hockey, and I guess Jagr chafed Jagr a little bit there.
Yeah. I can't remember if the dying alive, the infamous I'm dying alive comment was made during the Constantine era. I want to say it was. So the Penguins enter the season as a team that is still competitive, mainly because they have the best player in the league. But it's certainly not a team that's anywhere close to competing for a Stanley Cup. They're really a middle-of-the-pack hockey team entering that season. So that's what's going on the ice. Meanwhile, there is a lot going on off the ice. So Howard Baldwin had bought the team from Eddie DeBartolo in 1991. And that was a good time for the DeBartolo family to sell, because the Penguins had just won the Stanley Cup. So you're selling the best team in the league, right?
Yeah, I guess they're running out of malls to build.
Yeah. Yeah, you can't have too many of those. Well, and they own the San Francisco 49ers as well.
Yeah, but his father made his money building like Century 3
and
bunch of malls in Ohio. They're from Youngstown.
Right, that's right. I forgot about that.
Yeah.
So they decided to sell the Penguins, and Howard Baldwin is a guy that he was a movie producer, and he had owned some like minor league sports franchises, but this is kind of his first foray into major pro sports. And Baldwin's entrepreneurial kind of strategy was to buy things with very little of his own money invested. So for example, his actual cash investment in the Penguins was, wait for this, it was $1,000. That's it. He bought the Penguins with $1,000 cash. Now,
of a used car.
I wish I would have known you could buy an NHL franchise for $1,000. That would have been a good thing to know. The rest of it is assumed debt and capital provided by other partners. So no, he doesn't just pay $1,000 and get the Penguins. He has to bring in partners. And his biggest partner is a group called SMG. They're the group that manages the Civic Arena, where the Penguins play at the time. And he gives a large percentage of the revenue streams from the arena's luxury boxes and advertising and parking, all that kind of stuff. He gives that to SMG in return for the financing that Baldwin needs when he buys the team. This is an unusual deal. Most sports franchises receive most of the revenue from their arena or stadium operations. That's why you have sports teams holding cities hostage over new buildings, right? Because they get so much revenue from those luxury boxes and things of that nature.
Well, plus I think most of the owners realize that owning a building is basically a white elephant, because, you know, for some reason, those things don't seem to appreciate like a normal real estate. I'm not sure why, but it seems to be that once they can offload that expense onto the local government, which is sucker enough to go for it, why you're giving billionaires, you know, free stuff, I don't know. But hey, it is what it is, and if you can do it, more power to you, I guess.
Exactly, and that's what owners typically do. In this case, Baldwin has an older building and he's not getting a lot of the revenue from it. So that ends up causing some problems later. At the same time that's happening, he also starts giving out enormous contracts in an effort to keep the team relevant in Pittsburgh. Now that's not, that you could say that was a bad idea. I don't think it was. I mean, it was kind of what he had to do at the time. Number one, player salaries are skyrocketing in general. But at that point, the NHL had finally had a real TV contract, and the league is making a lot more money. It's becoming a lot more in the spotlight. And so player salaries in general were going up. And I think also, you know, he looks across town, he sees what's happening with the Pirates, where they were losing all their big stars and they were starting to become irrelevant. And the Penguins did not have the generational kind of set of fans that the Steelers and Pirates did. You know, Steelers and Pirates had, you know, my dad was a fan and his dad was a fan. And the Penguins really didn't have that. The Penguins' popularity was still fairly new at this time.
Yeah, I think, too, what happened, and I think I've said this before, is like the way that the NHL was structured was more like baseball, whereas, like, you have all these regional networks because you have 82 games to cover, right? Yeah, so it's not like football where they negotiate as an NFL as a whole. There are some games that are nationally televised, but for the most part, it's regional. And when you end up with regional TV contracts like that, you run into the same problems that baseball has, where you have teams, markets like New York, maybe not LA at the time, but definitely New York, Chicago, Boston, Toronto, Montreal, especially Toronto and New York. It's just a license to print money. I mean, the money that they can put up and generate through their regional TV contract is not a revenue stream that the Penguins would have access to. So that was something else that works against, you know, the Pirates worked against the Penguins at that time until hockey finally, you know, saw the handwriting on the wall and realized they were either going to go the way of the dodo or get a salary cap. So,
right. Right. But that doesn't happen until the mid 2000s.
Right. Right.
So at this point you have the big salaries. Now you mentioned that the Penguins aren't a big market team. Well, other smaller market teams could afford those big salaries because they had the revenues from their buildings, from the
luxury boxes. I don't know if they
could
afford it, but they could probably more readily afford it.
Exactly.
It definitely gave them another competitive advantage on top of, you know, the Penguins, yeah.
Well, yeah, and by afford, I mean, like, not bankrupt you.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
And
I guess it's all relative. It's a relative term, yeah.
Right, and Baldwin, so Baldwin doesn't have that. He gave all that away to SMG. So now he's stuck with the cost side of things. But unlike other owners that are doing this, he's unable to make up for it on the revenue side. As the decade goes on, Baldwin makes more bad decisions. He accepts a $12 million improvement to the Civic Arena from city officials rather than jumping on the bandwagon with the Steelers and Pirates for a new building. So he basically takes a payoff here. We'll make some improvements to the Civic Arena, which by this point is the oldest building in the NHL. Rather trying to force the politicians to build him a new building. The Steelers and Pirates are successful in that endeavor, of course. And he's, you know, all he gets is a measly $12 million improvement, which doesn't do all that much. He also turns over a lot of the advertising and marketing rights to Fox Sports Pittsburgh. That's the network that televises the Penguins. He turns that over because he needs cash. So he's just sort of making bad decision after bad decision, trying to get to the next year and trying to basically keep his head above water. When Lemieux retires, the Penguins still owe him $32 million. What had happened with Mario Lemieux was he was the highest paid player on the team, and the team had asked him repeatedly to defer his salary until later. Now, you might ask, why would Lemieux even consider doing that? Well, it benefited Lemieux also, because if Lemieux says, no, you need to pay me now, then he knows the team is going to say, okay, well, that means we can't keep this guy, your winger, or that defenseman, that puck-moving defenseman that helps you score goals, right? So Mario wanted to win another cup. He agrees to keep deferring his salary, but when he retires, he says, okay, you still owe me that $32 million in deferred salary. You know, and I'm entitled to that, and I want my rest of my salary because I kept deferring it at your request, which anybody would, right?
Yeah, yeah. Mario was definitely good for that. I mean, it's a shame he, you know, eventually, yeah. I mean, it does work out for him in the end, but that definitely was kind of a really bad deal for him there.
It was. The other thing that happens when he retires, attendance plummets. I never realized this until I saw the figure when I was doing the research for this episode. What season ticket sales in Mario's last year were 12,000. They sold 12,000 season tickets. The year after that, they only sell 8,000 season tickets.
Yeah, that's going to be a problem. And I don't even think, what was the exceeding capacity of that arena? Was it 16?
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, not only do you lose 25%, you're only at half capacity. So
right.
you're really depending on walk-ups to make your money.
Yes, which, you know, is dependent on you being good, which is dependent on so many other
things. Well, the opponent, you know.
The opponent, the weather that night, I mean, everything, right?
Right.
So Baldwin brings in a guy named Roger Marino, who is a computer storage company executive from Boston, to invest $42 million of capital. This happens in 1997. Marino loses most of that money. Later says he didn't realize how terrible Baldwin's previous decisions had been. And by the fall of 1998, when this season is about to begin, Marino, who now owns the majority stake in the team, decides to file for Chapter 11 bankruptcy. So that's really where this all culminates, a whole decade of bad financial decisions in the fall of 1998. Culminates with the team having to declare bankruptcy, which is saying a lot, Steve. I mean, from a team that won back-to-back Stanley Cups just a few years earlier and then bankrupt.
Yeah, bankrupt is not a good place, although that's Chapter 11, so that's just reorganization, right? Yeah.
Yeah, and it's...
Chapter 13 is you're selling, like, the shelving and the seats out of the building.
Yeah.
So it's just a reorganization, which isn't as bad as Chapter 13. You're not, you know, Sears and, you know, that's Chapter 13 where you're not around anymore.
Yeah.
I can't think of a good example of Chapter 11.
Well, I mean, it's Chapter 11. Kmart
did a bunch of Chapter 11s and now they're gone. You know?
Chapter 11 is definitely the first step. And then, you know, and that is meant to protect you from your creditors as well.
Yeah, normally if you can come up with a plan that you can make money and pay them back, you can come out of that eventually. Chapter 13 is the one where you're, it was nice, but we're done.
Yeah.
We're out, yeah. Maybe.
Yeah, and coming up with the funds to get out of Chapter 11 is going to be difficult. So we mentioned Mario Lemieux. Where is Mario in all this? So he retires in the spring of 1997. And when he retired, he had said real openly his plans were to play golf and spend time with his family. He was not going to be a coach, or he wasn't going to be in a studio announcer or anything like that for the league. He just wanted to live a quiet life. He was going to stay in Pittsburgh, but he wanted to, he wanted to just be a family man and sort of get away from all of this. Well, when the team declares bankruptcy in the fall of 1998, Lemieux, who is an uninsured creditor, he stands to get absolutely nothing.
That's a big, people don't realize that. Because I only know this because I know people have gone through this. Like, your last paycheck, they can pay you 10 cents on the dollar. So I don't know what 10 cents on the dollar of $32 million, but.
Well, he did.
Definitely going to be 90% less than you should be getting.
He did sue Marino, and he won, I believe it was $5 million, so maybe that's the 10 cents that you're talking about or whatever that equivalent is. But that was all he got, and that was not a lot. I mean, you figure $32 million, that was years and years of him playing for the Penguins that he was owed. So now, he starts meeting with his advisors to talk about what do we do? And so now Mario's got a big problem. So the season starts under this ginormous cloud of financial ruin. The players are able to focus on hockey, though. At least that's what they're saying in the press. I went and I tried to find a bunch of old news stories from that early in that season. And, at least, again, in the media, the players are saying, you know what, this doesn't really affect us. The team's still able to meet payroll barely, thanks to loans and other, you mentioned, Steve, Chapter 11, other reorg. So they are able to write checks. And I think if you're an employee, if you're a player, some of these guys that play for other teams, I guess as long as you're still getting paid, as long as you're still at practice every day and playing the games, I can see where maybe it doesn't really affect you as a player. They do mention some things like they're not staying at luxury hotels on the road anymore. I did find a story about there was a broken water pump in the hot tub at their practice facility that didn't get fixed because the company that installed it never got paid. So there were little things like that, but nothing to be like, oh, woe is us, we can't go on with this season. So the financial issues aren't really interfering with the team's ability to play. And as the season kind of starts going, the Penguins come out of the gate and they're mediocre. And that's really what everybody expected of them. They make a big trade in late November of that year. They trade Peter Nedved and Chris Tamer and Sean Pronger to the Rangers, and they get Alexei Kovalev. Alexei Kovalev was a guy that was a big talent, had never really quite lived up to that talent, and ends up being a really good trade for the Penguins in the long term. In the short term, it doesn't really do all that much. Kovalev doesn't come to Pittsburgh and light things on fire. He does later, a few years later, but that first year he doesn't do all that much.
He could really skate, and like I know Don Cherry would sometimes say he dances too much, because he could at times like make unnecessary movements, but he could really like it was almost like I don't know like Michael Jordan, you know, like where he could really fake a guy out of his own skates, and that was you know he was really good at that, you know.
a couple of years later, they put him on a line with Straka and with Robert Lang, and that was after Mario came back, and that line was just amazing. And so those guys ended up, again, becoming really good players. But if you look at kind of the stats and everything for that season, Kovalev doesn't really end up being that big of a contributor. So by late January, by the All-Star break, the team's 20-15. And they're hovering right around that line of playoff teams or teams that qualify for the playoffs. You know, they're like 1 point ahead or something. You know, they could easily fall out of the playoff picture. So again, middle of the pack, sort of where everybody expected them. After the All-Star break, they get hot. They reel off a 10-game winning streak, which is a big deal. 10 games in a row in hockey is not easy to win. So that's significant, and it's really fortunate because it does save their season, because in their last 30 games, they only win 6 of their final 30 games. Now, I think, you know, a handful of those at least were ties, and you still get a point for a tie back then. But they did not win a lot of games at the end of the season, 6 of their final 30, and they finished the regular season as the number 8 seed, which is the final playoff spot in the Eastern Conference. So they barely squeak into the playoffs. One last note on the regular season before we start talking about the playoffs. The final regular season game is scheduled to be played at Madison Square Garden. And Wayne Gretzky, who's playing for the Rangers at this point, announces that he's going to retire. So this ends up being Wayne Gretzky's final ever game against the Penguins in Madison Square Garden. So that's a big deal. That gets a ton of fanfare. I think they painted like 99 on the ice. You know, just a big deal. And the game goes into overtime, and Jagr actually scores the game-winning goal in overtime. And Steve, I don't know how you feel about Wayne Gretzky. I never like hated Wayne Gretzky. I respected him. He's a great player, it's hard to not say he's, you know, the greatest ever, just based on the records and everything. But I always resented the fact that, you know, he was always worshipped as this, like, greater than Lemieux. And I just always thought Lemieux had more talent. Lemieux just had the injuries and the unfortunate luck. He also didn't have the players around him that Gretzky had early in his career.
Well, the refs didn't let people hit him. Ty Domi would beat people up. He had a lot of other things going for him. And two, it's always like it's a contrast of style, whereas I thought Lemieux was more of a one-on-one player, although Lemieux could pass too, and Gretzky was more of a distributor. You know, it's kind of like pick your poison. Like, it's almost like a point guard in basketball. Do you want the guy that drives to the basket? Like, you know, like Isaiah Thomas or like, Michael Jordan really isn't a point guard, or you want Magic Johnson, who's going to be the distributor. And the same thing with Gretzky and even Crosby. They're more of a distributor, although they both could score goals and they scored a lot of goals. Or do you want Ovechkin, who's just that right, not a center, but a right winger, who's just going to absolutely blister the puck from that dot, you know, and score a lot of goals that way. So it is a contrast of styles. But there were some other stuff too, was Gretzky was English. Canadian and Lemieux is French Canadian, and Canada is a weird country. I've done business with that country. Like when I would ship a lot of stuff for a warehouse, and we had a warehouse in Nova Scotia, and you would hope that it didn't go through Montreal because it would take 3 extra days because the French Canadians would always want to stick it to the English Canadians in Nova Scotia. It's just an odd dynamic. And then you throw in the Native Americans and the Western part of the country, that's kind of its own little deal. It's an odd little dynamic there. And I think that kind of carried over. Like Madden always says that about, you know, that they kind of stuck it to Lemieux because they didn't like, because he was French Canadian, not English Canadian. And, you know, I don't know. I mean,
well, that definitely seeped into the media because the most egregious example of that was the 1989 season. Mario Lemieux won the scoring title by 31 points. And I believe the difference was all goals over Gretzky. 31 points, and they gave the Hart Trophy to Gretzky because that was Gretzky's first year in Los Angeles. And they wanted it to be like, oh, look how he, you know, revived hockey in the United States and all this stuff. And meanwhile, Lemieux had a way better season. And that was when Lemieux, I believe when Lemieux famously made the quote about the only award he cared about was the Art Ross, the scoring title, because nobody voted on it.
I agree with him on that. That's why I don't follow the Heisman or NFL MVP. I don't really care. Lamar Jackson, congratulations. Hey, how was that first round playoff loss, buddy?
Yeah.
NFL MVP. It's same with all the Heismans. I mean, what does it mean? Ty Detmer. What did Ty Detmer ever do? He had a barely mediocre career. I mean, it's just like, you know, a Miss America or, you know, nice thing to have, but I mean, it doesn't mean much to me. I'm with Mario on that one.
I agree.
You can't fake goals. It either went in or it didn't. And, you know, at least it got like that with the Vezina too. The goalie award, like who has the lowest save percentage? There you go. There's your number. Take it or leave it, you know?
Right. Right. Yeah. And so I didn't hate Gretzky. He's a great player. You're never going to, you know, be ridiculous to say otherwise, but there were a bit of like, I remember watching that game kind of feeling a little bit of guilty pleasure. Guilty pleasure. He was sitting on the bench when Jagr scored that goal. And
I would have been better if he was on the ice.
That's true. That's true.
Would have been his minus, Rectus plus minus.
This kind of Jagr ends Gretzky's career with an overtime goal. And
did Jagr do the salute too? Because remember, he always did the Denver like.
Salute. Oh yeah, that was the Atlanta Falcons, wasn't it?
No, it was the Denver. Didn't they do?
Oh, it was Denver. You're right.
Salute. Yeah.
Yeah, the Falcons were the dirty bird or whatever. Yeah. Anyway, I think we're getting off track here, but it's a little of a passing of the torch moment. I mean, Gretzky is certainly not the best player in the league. Had not been for quite a few years at that point. He's definitely not retiring at the top of his game. But Jagr at this point is. Jagr wins the scoring title that year. Jagr also eventually wins the Hart Trophy. It's the only Hart Trophy he ever wins. It's his only MVP award. And it was, so he's at the absolute height of his powers in 1999. So the regular season ends, but the whole bankruptcy situation is far from settled. The two biggest creditors were SMG, who, as we mentioned, the group that owns the arena, and Mario. And both of them are entertaining the same idea, which is, hey, we can recover at least some of the cash owed to us by buying the franchise out of bankruptcy. So both of those groups are putting together plans. However, that being said, everything's, you know, still wide up, wide open, still wide. That being said, everything's still up in the air. There was talk of moving the franchise. Of course, you know, anytime something like this happens, it's like, oh, maybe they'll move to another city. But there really isn't an out-of-town buyer interested. So there's actually a real prospect, as hard as this is to believe, of just literally dissolving the franchise. Now that's happened many times in pro sports leagues before, but typically it's either in, you know, lesser-known sports leagues, or if it's in one of the major sports leagues, you know, it was back in 1929 when, like, the Lancaster Maroons or whatever folded in the middle of the season.
Pottsville Maroons, yeah.
You know, it's
not the Pottsville Maroons, no. I think they won a championship.
It's some bygone era.
Might have been the Canton Bulldogs. Or
but you know, in 1999, so you think of it as happening, you know, when before these leagues were well known. But you know, in the four big North American sports leagues, that's NFL, NHL, MLB, and NBA, the last franchise to cease operations is the Cleveland Barons, an NHL team, and that actually happens in 1978. So it was only 20 years before this that a major sports franchise and an NHL franchise had folded. And of course, you know, figures it was a Cleveland team. But it's not out of the question that that could happen, where the team could just cease to exist. So that's where things are headed into the playoffs. The first round playoff opponent is the number one seed, and that's the New Jersey Devils. We mentioned the Devils before when we talked about the trap and this era of clutch and grab. No franchise perfected that style like the New Jersey Devils. They are the absolute powerhouse team of this era. Between 1995 and 2003, they win the Eastern Conference four different times, and they win the Stanley Cup three times. They have not only, you know, a great defense and that style that they play, but they have arguably the league's best goaltender. Steve, you mentioned him before, Martin Brodeur. He's just a shutdown goaltender. The style, everything that they do fits around Martin Brodeur.
Was the only team to really stop them the Red Wings? And did the Red Wings ever beat them in the finals?
No, they beat the Red Wings in the finals. The only
did the Red Wings do back-to-back? Wasn't that 99? No.
No, so the Devils beat the Red Wings in 95. They beat the Stars in 2000, and they beat the Ducks in 2003. The team that beat them in the finals was the Colorado Avalanche in 2001, and that was a seven-game series. I mean, that went right down to the end. They won three cups, and they almost won a fourth. They were one game away from winning a fourth. Wow. So very good team. Not a popular team. You know, it's funny. Usually when you have teams that win that are dynasties, you have like a bandwagon set of fans. You have fans from outside that market that root for the team because they're winners. That didn't really happen with the Devils, you know. And it was because I think nobody really liked the style that they played. It was hard to get on board and be like, yeah, that team's awesome. You know, like it is with like a, you know, I don't know, Golden State Warriors and Steph Curry kind of, you know, bandwagon. Sort of like,
where do they play in New Jersey? Like, what's that, the Meadowlands? I mean, I don't think there's like a really big, like, metropolitan fan base. You have the Rangers and the Islanders in New York, and then you kind of have like, you know, where they had their Stanley Cup parades at?
Where?
In the parking lot. They did have the parking lot of the Meadowlands, yeah.
Nice.
It was seriously not even – I don't know where else they could have had them in New Jersey. I guess apparently not.
Yeah, so not well-liked and, you know, but, you know, very successful nonetheless. You can't say they weren't successful. For sure. And this year, 1999, they're the number one seeds. They're obviously heavy favorites in a 1-8 matchup. But the other reason that they're heavy favorites is because Jagr enters the series suffering from a pretty severe groin injury. They've just gotten worse and worse as the end of the season came. And so game one is in New Jersey, and the Devils win. It's a close game. The Penguins actually outshoot the Devils in game one. But Brodeur makes some big saves. Peter Sikora for the Devils scores twice. Peter Sikora, of course, later becomes a Penguin.
But he wonder scores... if he predicted any of those goals.
Yeah, yes. I don't know.
Yeah.
And you know, Jagr in that first game, he really struggles. The Devils, again, Brodeur really was what made them tick, but they had these defensemen, Scott Stevens, a Hall of Famer, Scott Niedermeyer, I believe, is also a Hall of Famer. They were both all over Jagr, and he's clearly not 100%. He can't do anything. And so the Devils take game one. And then the series, like, right off the bat gets ugly. The Penguins had acquired Matthew Barnaby in a late season trade. Matthew Barnaby, Steve, how would you describe him? He's not a goon.
No, he's like one of those classic agitators. Like, he's not gonna, like, I mean, he'll fight you, but that's not like, he's not like, like who Donald Brashear or, like, you know, Ty Domi, I already mentioned. He's not like a fighter. He's more of like an instigator where he tries to get you to take a penalty. He'll do like little cross checks when, or like, you know, when they get in the glass and they put their glove up in the face, you know, give them a face wash, like stuff like that. Like stuff that's not necessarily a penalty. Sean Avery, perfect example. Like stand in front of, that was my favorite. Like, was that Brodeur or Lundqvist?
That was
Brodeur because he played for the Rangers.
Yeah.
And he stood, they remember the NHL had to change the rule the next day because he put his hand in front of Brodeur's
face. Yes. Yes. Yeah.
No, Sean Avery is probably a perfect example of that.
Yes. And if you remember Sean Avery, you're right. Matthew Barnaby was a very similar player to Avery.
And he wasn't a goon. He wasn't a great player. He was like a mediocre player, but he just would just get under people's skin, just do it, like I said, like literally putting your hand in front of Brodeur's
face. Right.
And you didn't know who to root for in that case. You're like,
yeah, and Barnaby, so getting under the skin, he immediately ignites a feud with Devils defenseman Lyle Odelein. Actually, I should say reignites, because that's actually a long-standing feud, Barnaby and Odelein, from Barnaby's days in Buffalo. And he calls Odelein Cornelius. I've never seen Planet of the Apes, Steve, but apparently he thinks that
Lyle, I don't know why Odelein, he didn't go with Cornelius. Dr. Zayas. Did you ever remember The Simpsons had the musical version for Troy?
That, honestly, that's my like only
you Planet made of the Apes reference. Out of me.
You know, and I already know the spoiler of how it ends. So
that's not how the movie ends.
No. I know.
But it's a great movie. You should really watch it. It's,
I'll
it's the
get
opposite
right
of what the Troy McClure version is. But I digress.
So
Cornelius was the young kid who was kind of like naive, so I
okay,
I don't,
but he looks like an ape, right? Yeah. And so I
that
guess
was probably more of what I guess Matthew Barnaby was hinting at, not that is this guy, maybe this guy was naive, I don't know.
Right. And so Odelein then is quoted as saying that Barnaby's wife Christina is, quote, god awful to look at.
Yeah,
I mean, they're just taking like real personal shots at each other. So that kind of adds some fun to the series. But on the ice, you know, things aren't trending up for the Penguins, because Jagr for game two is now out. You know, game one, again, he was hobbled. In game two, he just can't play. And so what happens? Somehow the Penguins pull off a 4-1 victory in New Jersey in game two, which is stunning. They come back to Pittsburgh for game three, and again, without Jagr. And again, they win. They this time they overcome a 3-2 deficit with two goals in the first minute of the third period, and then end up hanging on for a 4-2 victory. Straka has a hat trick. The Civic Arena is rocking. The Post Gazette, the day after, in their write up, says that it feels like 1992 in the Civic Arena. And all of a sudden, the Penguins are up 2-1 in the series, and the Jersey fans and the media start getting nervous, because the Devils had won their division each of the previous two seasons, but were upset in the playoffs each time by a lower seed. And this 99 team was even better than those two teams. And now they're down 2-1 in the series to the number 8 seed, who's playing without their best player. So definitely some consternation there on the Devils side. But, you know, as good teams often do, New Jersey kind of rights the ship. They win game four in Pittsburgh, and then they go back to New Jersey and they win game five. And at this point now, this pendulum has completely swung the other way. New Jersey once again looks like a well-oiled machine, and the Pens just look overmatched. I remember watching those games. Okay, well, you know, we showed some life. That's good. But they're just better. I mean, they were just better than us. And we had no answer. And so now the Penguins are on the brink of elimination, headed back to Pittsburgh for game six. The good news is that Jagr who has not played in games 2 through 5, is going to come back for game 6 because the whole season's on the line. So he's going to force himself to play. Nobody knew if, you know, he was going to be anywhere near effective, but it was worth giving it a shot because this was it.
I think he had some acupuncture.
Is that what did it?
Yeah. There's little needles. They worked the trick.
Yes. So game 6 is played on May 2nd, 1999. It's an afternoon game. It's a Sunday afternoon game in Pittsburgh. It was an eerie kind of feeling when the game starts. I remember watching this. I was in my dorm room at Duquesne University. I just finished my finals. I was watching it by myself. And you know, I don't know how fans have felt of teams, you know, that have moved or that, you know, may not exist anymore, you know, kind of watching what may be that last game. But for me, I just remember, like, this is so strange. Like, this might be, seriously, it might be the last time I ever watch my favorite team play, because they may move to another city, or what seemed more likely at the time, they may just not exist anymore after today. And that's just a weird feeling. It's the only time in my life as a sports fan I ever had that situation. So that's the feeling going into the game. A lot of other people, you know, obviously in Pittsburgh felt the same way. The Devils take a 1-0 lead in the first period. The Penguins even up in the second. But then in the third period, Niedermeyer scores on a power play, and that gives New Jersey a 2-1 lead. A 2-1 lead is just absolute gold for a team like the Devils that play that defensive minded game, that have the best goaltender. Holding a 2-1 lead is not a challenge for them. So, you know, now the Penguins are frantically trying to come back, but, you know, they're not having any success. The minutes start to tick away. I remember in my head, I'm like flashing back to like the Stanley Cup years and my favorite moments, just kind of trying to savor, you know, what could be the last few minutes of Penguin hockey that I'll ever see. Jagr, meanwhile, he's not giving up. He ends up playing 29 minutes in this game, despite the major injury. And, you know, he's arguably the best player on the ice that day. But, it, you know, as the minutes tick away, it doesn't matter on the scoreboard because it's 2-1 Devils. But, you know, one thing you can say about Jagr certainly has a checkered history in Pittsburgh. A lot of love-hate with Jagr. But he was always clutch. I think, in my opinion, Steve, one of the most clutch players in the history of Pittsburgh sports.
Oh, you look at some of the goals he scored. Hey, even in 91, didn't he come off the bench and score one in overtime against somebody?
Yeah, that was against Boston, I think.
Yeah, then 92, he was part of that big comeback against the Blackhawks in the game one.
Yes, he scored magnificent goal, yep.
And then, of course, we're leading up to this.
Yeah, right? Yes. And so, with under 2 minutes left, Titov kind of storms into the Devil's end, and he's pushed into the corner. He kind of flutters the puck back towards the net where Jagr is. Brodeur's standing right in front of the net, and Jagr somehow jams it through to tie the game and send it to overtime. If you watch the replay of that goal, I still don't know exactly how it went in, but somehow he gets it through. And it's shocking because the game's now going into overtime. You know, just a minute ago, your season's over, and you're assuming that the season's over and the franchise is over. Now we're headed into overtime. So that was pretty shocking. In overtime, the Penguins definitely have the momentum because of that goal. You know, but the Devils are still shutting them down. About 9 minutes into overtime, they finally get a chance, and that is when this happens.
Pass didn't get there because of Stevens. Stevens fired it back off the board.
Three big plays on this shift by Stevens. Three.
Straka trying to get by. He does. Plays it across. Goal! Jagr!
So Straka breaks in. He crosses, does a cross pass, cross ice pass to Jagr. Jagr beats Stevens on the play, beats Brodeur, and he wins the game. it's a shocking and significant goal. It's a goal that not only wins the game, but breathes new life into the series and into the franchise. The team obviously was bleeding money. The home playoff games were huge money makers, and it was something that the team badly needed to be able to keep things going and to possibly be able to close a deal with another buyer. I want to read what Jagr said about that goal years later. He said, quote, "I remember that like it happened yesterday. We were losing 3-2 in the series. And if we would lose the first round, I think the team would move to Kansas City because they had no money. We had to make the second round to get the money for the payments. I came back and tied it with a minute and a half to go. Then I scored in overtime. That was probably my best game ever, I would say. My most important for sure. I'll never score a goal that important. Probably if I hadn't scored that goal, the team wouldn't be in Pittsburgh right now. Sidney Crosby would be playing somewhere else."
Jeez, it's a lot of repercussions there from one goal.
It is. The Penguins end up winning Game 7 at New Jersey. They still had to win Game 7, but they do. And the Devils players openly admit in the media that the series was lost when Jagr tied and won the game, Game 6 in Pittsburgh. I mean, they didn't give up for Game 7. I'm sure they still tried, but they knew at that point it was over. And so the Penguins went on to play a second round. They play a pretty spirited second round against the Maple Leafs, but they're ultimately eliminated in six games. Ironically, their season ended in that second round. Steve, you and I were watching that game at the trolley stop inn at Bethel Park, if you remember when the Maple Leafs scored that goal to end that season. You know, they still went a lot further than everybody thought they would. And then later that summer,
I'm sure two or, well, how many games did they play? Play six, so they're probably still the eighth seed. So what, they got two more home games out of that?
It would have been three. Games you would have been.
So yeah, three more sellouts. I remember there were a lot of Maple Leafs fans in town too. I guess it isn't that long to drive, but hey, money's money.
Yeah, I went to one of those games against Toronto, and there were a lot of Maple Leafs fans. But yeah, like you said, they were packed.
That's all right. The Penguins have won five Stanley Cups since 1967. Do you know how many the Toronto Maple Leafs have won since 1967?
It's a number less than one. I know that.
I think it's zero.
Yeah.
Wow. How do you screw that up with all that money? I mean, they literally have money to burn, and you can't win one in, what is it, 50 years? Come on.
I know. I know. That's a shame. It's a real shame. But for the Penguins, they
so that was a big win in Game 7 in a spirited second-round series against the Leafs. Unfortunately, fall short.
Right.
As they say, the rest is history, because later that summer, Mario, instead of taking his $32 million, just takes his takes it out as a team. They give him the team pretty much, you know. And it was, a big decision for Mario. He did take a chance, but he believed in hockey in Pittsburgh. And, you know, really it was, you know, makes him a legend. Outside of the Chief, I would say Art Rooney Sr., he's probably the second most legendary owner in Pittsburgh sports. I mean, the Galbraiths owned the Pirates, but really – for longevity and saving a sport and keeping a team alive through the rough years. For my money, I think it's the Chief, and then Mario maybe second. And maybe not even, might be 1A, 1B. Because yeah, they're both great people that do a lot of great things for people. And I'm sure there's many more stories we'll hear as Mario gets older about, you know, how good of a person he is. And, he gives money to cancer research. There's a whole floor in the Hillman Cancer Center named after him. He's donated money for rooms for children at Children's Hospital. He's very, very Chief. He reminds me a lot of like the Chief, even though it's kind of weird that, you know, he's not necessarily, he didn't grow up in Pittsburgh. He grew up in Montreal, but yeah, very interesting. There's very much characteristics between those two people.
Absolutely. Yeah. And, you know, Mario, to me, Mario's the real hero of this story. I mean, I, You know, so let's talk about that. Did that goal literally save the team, as Jagr said? And by the way, Jagr's not the only one to say that. Paul Staggerwald has said that. There's been lots of other people that have said, you know, that goal made all the difference. If Jagr doesn't score that goal, if the Devils get the next goal, you know, we may not have the Penguins anymore. How much legitimacy is there to that? I don't know that we'll ever know the answer to that question for sure. But I think it overshadows the fact that, you know, to your point, Steve, the real hero here is Mario Lemieux. A couple years ago, the Post-Gazette did a long form story on Lemieux, and they delved into the events that were going on at this time. And again, you know, the whole strategy for Mario was to buy the team and to get all his money up front. You know, not just get the team, but get all his money back, his $32 million. They're putting together this plan, and there's a story where Mario's attorney, a guy named Chuck Greenberg, gets a call from Mario on a Sunday morning, and this is what Greenberg said. He said, Mario called me and said, quote, "I've been up all night thinking. If I went through everything I did in my career only for the Penguins to leave town a couple of years later, what have I really accomplished? We have to make sure they stay in Pittsburgh." Lemieux had decided that he was no longer going to receive any money after acquiring the team. He would turn much of what he was owed into equity and also contribute the $5 million that he made from the lawsuit with Marino. Greenberg, his attorney, was taken aback. He asked Mario to take a minute and think about his family. He would be risking never getting the money or even losing money if the Penguins weren't successful. "That's the way it has to be," Greenberg recalls Lemieux saying. When Team Lemieux told the bankruptcy judges about this change in strategy, they became the favorite option. So it's really the unselfishness of Mario Lemieux. You know, Steve, you mentioned it was a risk. I mean, it was a huge risk buying that team. In that same story, his agent said he was so worried that Mario was going to spend the rest of his life in the middle of Monroeville Mall hawking autographs just to try to make some of his money back. And, you know, he had already gotten $5 million in that lawsuit, and now he's going to give that up and give up any chance of guaranteed money just for the virtuous act of keeping the team in town. And, you know, his attorney, his agent, all the people that, you know, were supposed to advise him are telling him that that's a terrible business decision. And honestly, it is. It's not a good business decision at all. But Mario cared more about the team than he did about
He was ever going to get that $32 million, and I'm sure he's seen that $32 million back plus, you know.
Oh yeah.
I mean, yeah. Like you said, they could have went belly up, but
very, very easily they could have went belly up. I mean,
he did eventually get the new. They desperately, like I've said before, like the Civic Arena is not a great place to watch hockey. It really wasn't. Like I remember going to games there and sitting in like level C, which is supposed to be not bad seats. And everybody kept standing up, and I kept wondering, and I noticed it was because the monitors and the overhang from the next level, you couldn't see the other side of the ice. To see the other side of the ice, you would have to stand up. And so the console was a big improvement, and that helped keep the team in Pittsburgh. And it's been, you know, a great thing for the Penguins and a great thing for the city. They have other events there. You know, you'd love to go see monster trucks run over stuff. That's always fun. And, you know, and concerts. And I think I saw Billy Joel there a couple times. So, it's benefited the city for sure.
Don't forget Disney on Ice. I've taken my daughters there as well.
Oh, I haven't been to Disney on Ice since I was a kid. Jeez.
Yeah, it's not it's probably just like you remember, just as bad.
Only with new characters, Aladdin and Frozen. And,
yeah. Exactly. To me, that's Mario's the real reason that the team is saved. But you know, this goal, it's still important. I think it has to rank as one of the most dramatic moments in Pittsburgh sports history. The championship wasn't on the line like it was when Mass hit the home run or when Santonio makes the catch in the Super Bowl. But, you know, the entire fate of the franchise was up in the air. And there's really no other moment in Pittsburgh sports that has that kind of background to it. So to me, this is still a pretty important moment. The aftermath of this, the Devils go on to win the cup the following year. You know, at that point, it was like, oh boy, this is going to be unfulfilled promise. Well, they bounce back. They win the cup in 2000. And then they go back to the finals in 2001 by defeating the Penguins, getting revenge on the Penguins in the conference finals. So the Devils make up pretty well. Team Lemieux, as you said, Steve, makes up pretty well. Not right away. There's some lean years there. But then they win the draft lottery for Sidney Crosby. The league implements a salary cap, all kinds of things. And the new building, like you said, you know, all kinds of things that favor the Penguins. And I would offer up that they are the toast of the town again.
Yeah, and they're quite on. They're, you know, with five Stanley Cups, they're the most successful expansion team, in outside of the original six, they're the most successful expansion team. I mean, yeah. I don't think any other. Well, the Flyers have two.
Right.
Who else?
St. Louis just won their first. Yeah, I mean. Yeah. I mean, also look within
Tampa Bay. Does Tampa Bay have just one still? Yeah.
Yep.
And Carolina only has one.
Right. Washington.
Dallas has one.
Yeah.
Buffalo's never won it.
Yeah.
Yeah. So they really are the most successful. You know, the Kings have two. That's another expansion.
Yeah. Yeah. The Devils, I think, came after the Penguins. They have three. I mean, so there's other teams.
Yeah.
That have
really,
success,
the Devils they're definitely the most, you know, they're definitely the most successful expansion franchise, I would say.
Well, and look at even within the city, they've won three championships since anybody else in the city has won anything. The Steelers won the Super Bowl in 2008 since then.
Yeah, so they haven't won since, yeah.
Yeah, since then the Penguins have won three championships. So that's all possible thanks to, you know, some combination of this goal and Mario buying the team.
Well, you know, at least it proved the team could be viable again and kept them afloat long enough to Mariota finally kind of, you know. Like I said, I think he made a calculation. I kind of could see $32 million. I could maybe see half of it or keep the team in Pittsburgh, own a hockey team, and, it, you know, not the worst thing in the world, you know. And Ken Sawyer came on board Burkle.
It was Burkle, right?
Yeah. Right. Burkle came on board and helped out with some money stuff. So, I mean, it definitely, you know, he had to hit some green lights going downhill, but, you know, things kind of broke out right for him, and it's nice to see the good guys win one.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And it's, you know, you can assign whatever level of importance you want to this goal, but I'm glad we're not living in a world where we had to see what happens if Jagr doesn't score that goal. That's for sure. Any other final thoughts, Steve?
No, just a great goal, and thank God for Jarmer, even though he never came back after all that. But we owe Jagr that one. Clutch player, Mario, you know, clutch in his own way, and, you know, it all worked out for the Penguins.
Absolutely. Well, thanks, everybody, for listening. Please check us out on Twitter or Facebook, Pittsburgh Sports Memories. Also, please check out our website. It's pittsburghsportsmemories.weebly.com. And we'll catch you next time.
Bye-bye.